how you view things. 3.5 hours after leaving Kathmandu, the warmth of a Bangkok evening envelops us, and it's lovely to feel the heat again. In Nepal, when the temperatures descended into the low 20s, we donned our fleeces, and the mere thought of sub-10 degree temperatures in England has us shivering. Here, the warmth of the Thai evening is luxurious, a sense of well-being radiating throughout our bodies as it seeps in, easing our tiredness from the flight. After negotiations, a taxi takes us into downtown Bangkok at 120 kilometers per hour. Flying through the traffic, Bernard comments that the last time he saw this speed, a very nice Turkish police officer was collecting for his retirement fund. Unpaid, the coloured speeding ticket still sits in the journal. Bernard is mesmerised by the road lights and white lines, carefully regulating the traffic. Surely so many highway lights are not needed. Perhaps half would be enough. Multicoloured traffic lights appear, red, amber, green, the likes of which we've not seen for ages. Noticing all these changes, he points out drivers staying in lanes, judiciously using indicators, letting people know where they're going. The reverse culture shock continues on checking into a hotel. It seems opulent after Pakistan, India, and Nepal. Constant hot water flows, and electricity pours out with not a power cut in sight. The TV displays multiple channels, while the radio receives more than static as English pop songs cascade from speakers. It feels strange at first and takes a few days to adjust, as no longer do we have to ask, what time's the power on today? It feels eccentric being able to enjoy simple things like showering under powerful jets nearly punching holes in your skin. Like thousands of little needles, the hot water never runs out, no matter how long you stay under it. We engage in familiar routines dealing with agents and customs to reclaim Bertha. 3 days later, she's in the agent's car park, where Bernard amuses a large crowd by reassembling her. Many handshakes later, we hunt for our hotel, hidden away among the towering blocks all around. We're stopped by a Thai police officer who haltingly tells of our heinous crime of going down a bus lane. Asking for Bernard's international driving license, the princely sum of 400 baht, about £8 or $5, is demanded for its return. Bernard starts to hum Stand and Deliver by Adam Ant under his breath while waiting for the paperwork to begin. It soon becomes obvious there is no paperwork, and so we receive our first introduction to Thai police procedures, involving a lot of smiling. Welcome to Thailand. Many people at this point will start to mutter, I wouldn't pay a bribe, no way, no how. And yes, you're right. It's wrong, bad, awful, shouldn't be done. It should be challenged wherever it happens. By giving him the money, it's condoning his behaviour. And no doubt, he'll set off to find the next Western rich passerby who drops a sweet paper. Then again, it's always possible to rant, rave, or quietly insist, while smiling, on a legal route. This will involve a cross-town visit to the local Thai police station, where numerous forms in Swahili, or Thai but equally indecipherable, will involve several hours of wasted time before culminating in a nighttime drive through Bangkok. Let me think. 2 seconds later, give him the $5 and be done with it. The funny thing is, when the off-the-record fine is handed over, he stops 6 lanes of busy traffic to enable us to turn round. Thus, being philosophical certainly helps when you come across situations like this. Now we just shrug our shoulders, leaving the purists to mutter about bribes. Back at the hotel, we turn our attention to Bertha's bruised luggage frame as she displays the scars of passing through Asia. Several breaks and cracks are revealed, needing welding before Bernard can remove the spanners cable tied across the weaknesses. Currently, the frame looks like a child's Meccano set is holding it together. But the building next door gives off the telltale flashes of welding, and clutching the pieces, we set off with one of the hotel staff to find their source. Clambering over piles of rubble and debris to enter the building, a wooden ladder is climbed 2 floors up to where several people hunch over girders. The hotel staff explain, and within minutes, the luggage frame is restored to its original shape, without any further need for spanners and cable ties. Meanwhile, Bertha draws crowds to the hotel entrance, while we use public transport, involving water taxis which ply the canals, along with the brightly coloured tuk-tuks or taxis, all sounding like Formula One racing cars, despite being powered by small motorcycle engines. Days later, we pack up and head north to see the famous River Kwai Bridge, along with the Australian Memorial of the Death Railway at Hellfire Pass. Heading out into the traffic, within 20 minutes, another unscheduled appointment occurs with the police. Things are not looking good. Officer One speaks no English, and Bernard is convinced he's done nothing wrong. Officer Two arrives and speaks a version of English learnt from Americans on leave during the Vietnam War. Drawing pictures on his hands, it seems we were travelling in the wrong lane. Bernard explains he was in the correct lane, but the officer jumped out into the middle lane on a busy 3-lane highway to stop the car in front, so he was forced to go around the car. The officer will have none of it. Wanting Bernard's international license, we know where this is going. He tells us the fine. It cost 1,000 baht, about £20, as he smiles and grins. The broad smiles and lovely nature of the officer does little to stop the huffing and puffing in the intercom. An impasse is reached as Bernard tries the "I'm a daft Englishman and have no idea what you're talking about." We quietly ponder whether to force his hand and insist on the paperwork. To go official will take hours, as the officer will not be there with it until his shift is over 6 hours later. Bernard hands over the fine, gets his license back, and puts it down as a toll for using the road. At times like this, it's all about how you view things. Now, stop the huffing and puffing from the back row. You sound like you have asthma. Think positive and be nice. At least he smiled a lot and never reached for the gun on his hip.